All right, so we're recording. Hi everybody. Welcome to the office hours. We have Paul Schwab this week giving a talk on Omimo and fingerprints and conquering the fingerprint chaos. So that's going to be very exciting. Next week we are going to do a roundtable discussion about the kind of hypothetical future XMPP 2.0. So if you have things you like, dislike, want to see updated in the future, be sure to come to that, and that'll be our first experiment in how this works with a big group discussion as opposed to a single person giving a presentation. So I suppose that's it. No more announcements. Please sign up. We have only, I think, one more topic after the roundtable, and then we're kind of nobody signed up for anything. So, please add your name to the list, give a demo, add a new discussion topic, add a presentation, whatever you want to do. So with that, I'll turn it over to Paul, and let's hear what he has to say.
First of all, thank you, Sam, for the introduction. And let's get started. The title of my talk is Conquering the Fingerprint Chaos, or How Can We Solve the Complexity Problem of Multi-Device End-to-End Encryption? First up, what is the goal of this talk? This is not a protocol presentation. There's not a XAP yet, which is presented. This is just an idea, and it's not a new idea either. So it already has been explored somewhere else. So the goal of this talk is to spark a discussion of how this idea can be applied to XMPP to solve the problem of the fingerprint chaos. So very quick about me. Hi, I'm Paul, also known as Vanitas Vitae. I've been in the XMPP community for a few years now, since 2016, I guess. I'm a contributor to the SMEC XMPP library. I'm very interested in encryption and co-authored some encryption-related specifications. And so about fingerprints in end-to-end encryption, you know that end-to-end encryption is only really or can only really guarantee security properties like confidentiality and integrity and stuff like that if the users are verifying fingerprints. So what is a fingerprint? Basically, a fingerprint is an identifier, a unique identifier of an encryption key. So if two users are communicating with each other and they don't compare the fingerprints, then there's no guarantee that they are really encrypting messages to the right key. And there might be an attacker in the middle, which is then able to listen in on the communication and even change messages and modify content and stuff like that. So ideally, each partner of the communication would compare fingerprints to be sure that they are communicating with the right communication partner. So let's see how different messaging applications solve this issue. So first up, we have WhatsApp. In WhatsApp, you don't have to, but you can verify a security code. It looks like this. So there's a QR code that you can scan from the device of your communication partner, or you can manually compare these numbers. And if those numbers match up, then you can be sure that there's no one listening in on your communication. So then we have Threema, another very popular encrypted instant messaging application. They solved it in a way that there's this Threema ID. And if you would click on that, it would again show you a QR code that you can scan to verify that the contact that you're communicating with with the same contact. Lastly, we have Signal, which used to look like on the left here, where there were two fingerprints. First, the fingerprint of your of the person you are communicating with, and then your own fingerprint. But the Signal developers realized that people are not really familiar with the concept of a fingerprint. First of all, a fingerprint is usually considered to be a sensitive piece of information. So people were not sure, should I really tell my contacts my fingerprint? Should I share it? And then there's the issue that there are two of them. So again, which one has to match with which one? And yeah, the solution that the Signal developers came up with which I think is a very good solution, is to combine those two fingerprints, mangle them together into a single number, a safety number, they call it. And if this number is the same on both devices, on the one of your own and that of your peer, then again, the communication is safe. So, yeah, what do we do? How do we solve this this problem? Yeah, this is a screenshot of conversations. And first up, you can see there are multiple fingerprints. Like this, in this case, there are three, but there might be many, many more. Yeah, users need to keep track of which keys are trusted. Let's be honest, nobody does that. Daniel introduced the concept of blind trust before verification, which basically means that the app will not bother you with fingerprints as long as you don't as you don't show interest in comparing fingerprints. And as soon as you scan one fingerprint manually, then the app will annoy you with fingerprint. It will often prompt you to verify fingerprints, and I think that this is a good first start, but it's more a cure for the symptoms and not a long-standing solution. And yeah, this problem of multiple fingerprints per user only gets worse when we start talking about encrypted group chats, because then you have this times the number of participants, and nobody wants to really deal with that. This is a quick call I made yesterday prior to the talk, asking how many Omemo keys people have, or Matrix sessions, which is basically the equivalent to an Omemo key. And I think I set the scaling a little bit wrong, because the people in the comments afterwards told me that most of them have like 10, in the region of 10 keys, and the scaling was a bit off. And this again shows how bad the problem really is. So what does that mean concretely? This is how this situation may look like. Each fingerprint belongs to a device of the contact. In this case, the first fingerprint might be from conversations, the second one might be Dino and maybe Gajim. And if I flip this little toggle here, that means that I trust the fingerprint of that device, and that I want to encrypt messages to it, and also show messages that come from this device, that I want to show them as trusted, basically. The problem is there are too many keys. So what can we do? Well, it is obvious we have to somehow reduce the number of involved keys, because less fingerprints means less chaos, so problem solved, right? This concept can be described as identity key sharing. This is basically what Signal does. signal if you want to use their desktop client. You have to scan a QR code, and then there's a temporary session between your smartphone and your desktop client, which transfers the signal identity key from your device over to your desktop, and then your desktop and your phone share the same fingerprint. This is possible with Omimo. We could do that. In that case, each device pair, so let's say your phone and your friend's phone, still will have their own session. And the session will be different from the session between your friend's phone and your desktop client. But contacts would only see one fingerprint per contact, which would be an obvious, which would be an improvement. But there are also some problems, like, for example, what happens if I lose my phone? Because now I have to somehow replace my identity key on all my devices. And also this solution would be exclusive to Omimo, because it would not work with OTR, for example, or with other encryption solutions like OX. Speaking of OX, another solution to this problem would be to switch to OpenPGP for XMPP, which is OX, because there each user only has a single key. We have nice things such as access to encrypted message archives. We could reuse the Web of Trust. We could reuse our already established and beloved OpenPGP keys that we use for email encryption. Yeah, and profit, right? Yeah, it's just a joke. what should we do instead is maybe a little bit counterintuitive. Let's just add even more keys to the chaos. So this idea is borrowed from Matrix, and I see that we even have the author of that idea with us. Hubert is the author of the Matrix specification change proposal, I think it's called. The idea is basically we use a dedicated key as the cryptographic user identity key. What does that mean? Well, if we look at Omimo, it is a little bit strange that the key that we use for encryption is also used as the user's identity key, or used to identify the user. And it's a good idea to separate the concerns here a little bit, so that we have a key which is only used to identify the user and handle the encryption with other keys. Because one more observation with Omimo is that even though the Omimo identity key is called an identity key, it is more like a device key, really. It really should be called Omimo device key. And also, Omimo keys are not as long-lived as we would like them to be, because people switch phones, people test new versions of their clients, and Omimo keys get lost all the time and are being replaced with other keys. So what do we do? We have an account-wide identity key, and when users add new contacts, they only verify this single identity key, and that key then signs a set of signing keys, and those signing keys sign device keys, which again sign Omimo keys. It sounds a little bit wild if you think about it at first, but it really makes sense. So this is what it would look like. We have the this graphic is totally stolen from the Matrix guys. So we have a master key, it's called here, which is basically the account-wide identity key of Alice in this case. And this key is used to certify a self-signing key as well as a user signing key. If this if it really makes sense to divide those into multiple keys or in how do I say it? It's up to debate how many of those signing keys we need, but we can figure that out later. But the main point is that the master key publishes a statement that says, hey, this is my self-signing key. And with the self-signing key, this self-signing key then signs device keys. In this case, Alice has two devices, a PDP-11 and an Osborne 2. And those device keys then again would sign the Omemo identity key, for example. And then we have a chain from the master key down to the Omemo key. On the other hand, we have the user signing key, which is used to sign the keys of contacts. In this case, for example, the master key of Bob. And again, Bob has a self-signing key, which signed his own Dynabook and his VAX. And if Bob uses his user signing key to sign Alice's master key, then we have a chain of trust, because we can now say if the VAX device of Bob wants to send a message to the PDP-11 of Alice, he just checks if there's a path from his own master key down to the PDP-11 of Alice. And in this case, obviously, we can go from here to here to here to here to here, and the chain is complete. When do we sign devices? Or let's ask the obvious question: why do we have two signing keys here? Why are there a user signing key and a self signing key? Why don't we just use the master key to sign Omemo keys, for example? And the answer is separation of concerns, because this key is, ideally, this key would last as long as Alice has an XFAP account, and maybe even longer than that. Maybe I will talk about that later, but maybe we can use this key across accounts. Like, for example, if Alice has a work account and a private account, maybe she can even use this key on both accounts. And those keys here, the self-signing key and the user-signing key, those can be replaced, which is a nice thing, because keys might get lost. And this means that we can put the master key onto a YubiKey, for example, or hide it somewhere in a safe, because we don't really need it that often. The onboarding of new devices, let's say Alice adds a smartphone with conversations on it, then she would use the self-signing key and the self-signing key only. We don't need the master key for that. And with the self-signing key, she would sign the device key of her conversations client. And so this key, or this set of keys, this would be the set of keys that needs to be, or where the secret parts would need to be shared between devices. So if, for example, Alice adds a new conversations client, they would somehow fetch their secret set of signing keys, maybe from PubSub. We can put them there encrypted, like, for example, in the OpenPGP specification, there's a key synchronization mechanism which uses PubSub and a random password. So if we onboard a new device, all we need are those two, or maybe this one, basically, this signing key, which can then be used to sign the device and add it into the graph of trusted devices. Why do we have a self-signing key and a user-signing key? This yeah, it is separated between the those two keys because really those two keys have different different security levels. We wouldn't want an attacker to get hold of our self-signing key, so maybe we can just not, we can secure that better by having a longer password on that one, as we have on the user's signing key, for example. And if an attacker manages to get hold of either of those keys, we can just issue a new one, some replacement keys. We generate those on a new device. Then we need access to the master key, so the user has to unlock that, or I don't know, bring the YubiKey with them and pull it onto their device. And then we can issue new certificates for those keys, and yeah, basically replace the lost or outdated keys with a new set. Then again, we also would need to recreate all the signatures that we made on our device keys, but that's not too much of a problem, I guess. Yeah, so I think this is a really good solution to the fingerprint chaos. It comes with some risks and some problems, but there's also some nice chances. So the chances are simplified key management. I mean, really, you have to think a little bit about it to understand how it works. But once you have once you understood the idea, I think that for the user, if the client implements everything correctly, this would lead to a better user experience because we don't have to redecide which keys we want to trust on each and every one of our own devices. And there are some other nice possibilities and chances. For example, in companies, we could use a company certificate authority, which signs identity keys, the master keys in this graphic, which would lead to the situation where we wouldn't even have to decide if we trust the key of a coworker because the company's certificate authority already established that trust for us. The secret identity key, the master key, can be stored offline or maybe even on a YubiKey. We can recover from stolen devices and stolen device signing keys. As I said, if we lose a device, ideally this device does not have the master key, or at least the master key is still encrypted. And in that case, we can simply replace the self-signing keys and user signing keys, withdraw the signature for the device, and we are done with it. Another side effect is that now each user only has to verify a single fingerprint of their contacts. There's no more list of 20 Omimo fingerprints, but there's only the master or the identity key that we have to compare, which means we can do stuff like signals, security numbers, which is also very cool. And which is very exciting is if we have, if I go back, if we have a single master key and each device has a device key, we can finally do stuff like cryptographically signed offline device capabilities, because nowadays in XMPP, if we want to know the capabilities of a device, this device has to be online, and only then we can do a send an IQ to them and ask them, hey, do you support this and that? And that is problematic when it comes to end-to-end encryption, because we don't know, we know that a device supports, let's say, OpenPGP because it published a public key, but we can't really go further than that. But if we have per device keys, we can use those to publish verifiable information, which is then available offline. Also, we can do stuff like verifiable account migrations. If we if we switch to another account, there's currently accept for it, I think. I have forgotten the number, but that was never really verifiable. So most clients that implement it, I think probably only Gajim does, but I think Gajim will not automatically replace the contact in your contact list with the new account, but only show you a hint or something like that, a prompt, hey, this account might have migrated, because that information was forgeable, right? The server or someone else could just pretend that the user migrated to another account. But now we have a way to verify this. The risks. More keys mean more complexity. Complexity means possibilities for errors or misunderstandings. So a good user interface is a requirement. Why am I talking about this topic in the first place? I'm currently writing my master thesis, and in there I did a proof of concept implementation of a mechanism like this, which has a horrible user interface. So I learned the hard way that a good user interface is a requirement when it comes to this. Signing keys must be secured. That means that there are more passwords to remember. This is still an open problem, because ideally we do not want to reuse the account password, because that may be known to the server owner, and then we don't have end-to-end encryption anymore. But so we have to choose another password for the signing keys, which means the user has to remember or write down one more password, which is not ideal. Then PubSub might not be perfect for keys. I'm not 100% sure about that. Maybe it is, but I have some suspicions about that. How would we implement that? That is the question. I'm not yet sure about that. But what I'm pretty sure about is that we shouldn't reinvent the wheel and reuse existing specifications. A possible candidate for the key stuff would be X.509, which is tailored to certificate chains. And this basically is a certificate chain. So X.509 would be a good candidate for that. Another candidate that I used in my implementation is OpenPGP, which brings some complexity with it, but it is also possible to use OpenPGP, but I think X.509 is probably simpler and does everything we need. And we can use PubSub for distribution of key material and signatures, I think we can discuss if that's a good solution. That was the presentation, and now I think it's time for questions and for discussion. So I see I have a lot of questions or a lot of text in the chat. There's no multi-device with Signal, Threema, or WhatsApp. with Signal there is some multi-device, but only your phone and desktop or laptop. But it's not like with Omimo where you can run your chat application on every device that you want. Normal users can't check other keys by QR code, but hold the master key secure and separated. Yeah, That's a good point. Let's say the proposed solution would enable a user to hold their master key secure and separated, but it doesn't force them to do so. Yeah, but if there's company policy or something like that, I think this approach would be possible to be implemented with a policy. Yeah, I think it's good for companies. Yeah, I think it can be implemented in companies, but also in the truly decentralized federated world. So I think a company certificate authority which certifies user keys is a nice to have, but it's not necessary, and it probably works just as good without. So, any more questions? Trust establishment based on trust levels seems to be tricky and a bit arbitrary in OpenBGP's world of web of trust. Do you have in mind a setting or similar trust establishment for these keys or something else altogether? Yeah, if we go back to this nice graphic again, I think personally, I wouldn't try to establish a web of trust, not in the sense that you can query a master key or an identity key and see who else is trusting that key. I think that's not a way that I would tackle this. In fact, there might even be a problem if we just do everything that's in this graphic just as it is in this graphic, and that is if we publish those signatures, the signatures on our contacts, identity keys, if we publish those so that everyone can see it, we would leak our social graph, right? So we can see that, or an attacker could see, hey, Alice has signed Bob's master key, so Alice and Bob must be communicating with each other. So what we really want to do is create signatures, but we don't hand those signatures over to Bob, but instead we store them somewhere safe or somewhere where only we can access them. So we have to encrypt them somehow and publish them to PubSub, for example. And then we can, on our PTP 11 in this case, use a key to get access to those signatures and see, oh, there is a signature for Bob's master key. So yeah, there are some hurdles, but I think it is possible to overcome those without sacrificing privacy. Yeah. Have you thought about using one of those keys, or maybe it's a different set of keys signed by the master key to log into the XMPP server? That would also be nice. Yeah, I think isn't there already XAP that allows for a certificate or something to be used to sign in? I think it would be possible to combine that. I haven't thought about that, but that might be possible, yeah. Wouldn't you need to share the private key across many devices then? Yeah, I think that was about the encryption key, which is used to encrypt the signatures, right? Yeah, that key also has to be shared across the devices. That's true. Yeah. Oh, that's what that was in reply to the login keyring. Okay, yeah. I'm not sure if you want to use one single key for all your devices to sign in, but you probably want to have a different key for each device and somehow link those together so that you can use them to log in. Yeah, I think sharing the same key across all devices is probably not a perfectly good idea. And about the encryption keyring, about the encryption key used to encrypt signatures, that also has to be somehow shared across the devices. And there's also not a perfect solution for that out there, I think. But I think it's doable. We just have to think hard enough about it. Yeah. Are there any more questions? Or have I overlooked a question, maybe even?
I wonder if you've thought about the... So one, you mentioned possibly reusing X509, and I think this sort of maps onto exactly what it does really well. But there's always the issue, especially on the web, where because of the giant kind of tree of trust and having to do loop detection and go back and possibly having multiple paths to any specific endpoint that, or leaf that you're looking to get to, there's always that sort of issue where the web, it can be difficult. You know, you go to a website and you get some certificate error because it's been configured wrong and the chain couldn't be detected and a different route couldn't be found. And I wonder if you've thought about that at all in terms of this. Would it be easier to always be able to find a valid path? Or would we have the kind of the same issues where sometimes you run into errors where it's difficult or impossible to find a valid path, even though one should exist?
Well, I think the all paths would probably look the same. I don't think we would do stuff like have another device down here, for example. I think it's always you go from your device to your master key, and from that device to your user signing key, from that to the contact that you want to send a message to or just receive the message from and want to check if that key is valid. From that down then to the devices, find the right device, and even further down, to the self-signing key of that device, of that user, down to the device, and then check if there's a signature for the encryption key that was used to encrypt the message that you received. So the path should, as Syndes is saying, it should be very strict. Yeah.
To follow up, because I think I just made this, realized this. So the simpler way I could have asked that, I suppose, is does this mean there is a single identity key per account and a single device key per device? And then, of course, all the keys under that?
Yes, that's the idea. So you only have a single identity key or master key. And each device has a single device key, which can be used to sign information that belongs to that device, not only encryption keys, but also, as I said, for example, capabilities. If, I don't know, can't think of a good example, but if we want to have some capabilities that we want to share or have available offline, but that we need to sign, we can do it with this, with the device key. Yeah, if we want to think about how, for example, OpenPGP or OX fits into this image. OX, ideally, there's only a single OpenPGP key for the whole account, and that's also shared across all devices. So OX, the OX key would probably live somewhere here, where it is also maybe signed by either the self-signing key or by a, let's call it, account-wide information signing key or something like that. Yeah, so it's also possible to apply this scheme to other encryption methods where there are not keys per device, but a single key per account, or maybe keys that are not bound to devices, but of which there could be multiple of. Yeah, so I think this approach is quite flexible in that regard. And I think the Matrix guys already have some experience with it. And I have heard that it's mostly good experience. So we should give it a try and borrow this idea and apply it to XMPP as well. Okay, I don't see any more questions. So if you want to ask a question, do it now. Okay, can someone clearly identify a master key if they catch one device and or identify messages from specific user? So the question is a deniability, okay. I think deniability in the sense of, for example, in Omimo is not handled at this level, but further down. So the in Omimo, the user can deny that they created a message because of some magic. But the identity key has always been the Omimo identity key has always been supposed to be bound to a user. I think that was also the reason why they called it an identity key, because it's bound to the identity, and it's also verifiably bound to the identity. So I think when a user receives a message, they can verify that this message was somehow created by the sender, which has this and that identity key. So it is possible to for the recipient to check the authenticity of that message. But for an outstander, I think it is possible to deny that they sent that message. So I think there's no way to prove for the recipient of a message to for them to prove to an outstander, to a third party, that the message belongs to the or was sent from the sender, I think. So I don't think that this scheme is on the same level where deniability is implemented. I think deniability is implemented further down. I think the properties of the underlying protocols are preserved. Omimo's deniability is preserved no matter if the master key has signed the identity key or not. Yeah, that's basically what I tried to say. I hope I could bring that over. In double-edged, deniability comes from the fact that the messages are authenticated via HMAC instead of via a signature. And with an HMAC, either participant could have created the MAC. Okay, I didn't know that. There are some shared notes. Okay, that's just a sign-up link. Okay, if there are no further questions, then I think I would wrap up this talk. I hope I could spark some discussion and hopefully one or another of you are now eager to have something like that in XMPP, so that we can form an initiative to create a specification that can be used to establish this idea into XMPP clients. Also, we are kind of planning to create a specification for that, and by me I mean Sundays and me. So if you have any more points to discuss or something like that, feel free to reach out to either of us or send something to the mailing list. We would like that. Okay. Thank you.